your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's restless heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy. And nothing can keep us apart. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. Your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. Is your love and justice, God of Jacob. You use the weak to lead the strong. You lead us in the song of your salvation. And all your people sing along. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. Your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. Is enough. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough for me. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. Is enough. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough for me. Your grace is enough. Heaven reaching down to us. Your grace is enough for me. Covered in your love, your grace is enough for me.
Right. Praise God. Well, good morning, everybody, guys. Welcome to Timberline. We're excited to see you guys here. We're excited to worship with you. Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. Yes, you did. You have been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaving
couldn't earn it. I don't deserve it. Still, you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. I was your foe, still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me, yes you did. You have been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
Sing it, church.
There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. No shadow now, there's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found. He's the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
Good morning. You may be seated. Welcome to Timberline this morning, you guys, on this beautiful, beautiful June Sunday. I want you to grab your programs out for a moment. Just a couple of announcements for us today. In your program, let me start with those in here. If you haven't already signed up for the Timberline Night at the iCubs, You have this Sunday and next Sunday. Next Sunday is the deadline for signing up for iCubs tickets. So make sure to invite friends, neighbors, coworkers, whomever you would like, and make sure to get your names on the sign up in the lobby. We have a great group of people. There's a couple of pages worth of names and numbers on there. So make sure all the information you need is on here. Stop by the lobby and make sure to sign up. Men, you probably noticed the men's group sign up is still up there. I know there's a lot of names that aren't actually on there that are actually joining into groups. If you missed last Sunday, you missed the deadline for getting a men's group, we extended it one more week. Find a group, plug into a group, you won't be behind. So just slide right on in there, and then that tripod's going to go away this week. So get into one of the men's groups. We have a meeting on almost every day that ends with a Y, basically except for Sunday, different men's groups throughout the community, mornings and middays, afternoons and whatnot. So make sure, guys, sign up for get connected into those groups. Let me put a special date on your radar. Faith in Action Sunday is coming up very quickly, June the 30th. That is when we close these doors. We go out and serve the community in practical ways in the name of Jesus. I want to invite you to be praying about who God might be calling you to serve. It might be your next door neighbor. It might be a person across the street. It might be a coworker. Who knows who that is? But we go to serve and we share the love of Jesus as we go and serve those in need. Be praying about that. We will also have a few opportunities that we'll do as kind of a larger group opportunity coming up. You'll hear about those again, hopefully next week. And as a reminder, Faith in Action envelopes, keep praying about what God's wanting you to sacrifice financially. We will take that collection and we'll use that money to go and serve and help answer the financial needs in the different ways we're going to serve. So we're going to take that offering the Sunday before June the 30th. So that's 2 weeks from now. A reminder for you now, the other thing in your program you're going to notice is a sign up for t-shirts, probably more so on the parent side, but kids, you can go nudge mom and dad on this one if you would like. This one is a sign up to get our brand new Timberline t-shirts. Why would you want to have those? Well, first of all, we're going to try to have those out. It says right there, you'll be able to pick them up actually on Faith in Action Sunday if you would like. We might be able to get those a little sooner than that, not for sure on that. But the deadline to sign up for the brand new Timberline t-shirts is coming up next Sunday. Now, why the deadline and why the urgency? Because you're going to see a sign up out in the lobby that we're inviting you to be a part of the 4th of July parade, part of the Timberline exhibit, part of the Timberline promotion. We're going to have some fun with our entry. And I'm not sure, I can't even share all the details yet. They're still coming together. But what we would love to do is have a sea of Timberliners wearing the same Timberline t-shirt and handing out goodies. And you'll hear more about that in the time ahead. So with that, let me show you. I don't know if we can blow that up any bigger or not. At the same time, here's your Faith in Action. Here's your 4th of July t-shirt. And I want you to look at that very closely because what you see on the front there is our very beginning, the first day today or this week if you're on Facebook. You notice we have, with the help of our church unique team and the elders, we have and some other graphic designers in our body, we have designed a brand new Timberline logo. So we hope you love that. We'll talk more about that logo and what those three triangles actually mean in that logo. But let me just help you. It has something to do with know, love, and serve God, each other, and our neighbors. And so we want people through us, and we want they're going to know who we're about. Being, we want to know, love, and serve God, know, love, and serve our neighbors, and each other, and know, love, and serve our neighbors. We hope that logo will communicate that. We are praying that everybody would love to get a t-shirt, and for those who would like one, go ahead and fill that out, and how many you would want, and each of the t-shirts are, I believe it says $9 on there, am I correct? Each t-shirt's $9, so we'd love to have everybody wearing t-shirts, and if you are willing to walk in the 4th of July Urbandale Parade, we would love to have you sign up in the lobby, and we'd love to have as many people help hand out stuff and make a great representation of Timberline to Urbandale. Okay, I think that covers all the big rocks. Lastly, I almost forgot one. Continue to pray for our Utah mission team. We have two mission teams rising up and getting ready to go. We have a Utah mission team. We are going to commission them next Sunday on Father's Day, and then they are heading out to Manti, Utah to go reach the Mormons with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Pray for that team. There's somewhere, last I knew, between 2,000 and 2,500 left to be raised in order for them to go. And so we're praying between today and next Sunday that God would provide that last $2,000 to $2,500. Maybe God would prompt you above and beyond to help support them to go. If so, you can give online or you can do it through the Joy Box. The other mission trip that's rising up is a Romanian mission trip. I think we have two people committed to go as part of a multi-church emphasis to go to Romania to serve alongside of our missionaries, Doug and Jen Droll. So you'll hear more about that in the weeks to come. But I want to give you that heads up on the Utah mission trip for right now and the financial need ahead of us. All right, with that being said, stand up and greet one another for these next few minutes.
I can see the clouds rolling. I can feel the winds, they try to shake me. I will not be moved.
Wait, let's knock that over.
My feet are on the rock. I can feel the water.
Good morning.
Rise.
Good morning. Was that coming through only the...
So stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand.
What's not to love about you?
All right, Quest Kids, you are dismissed. Quest Kids are dismissed this morning as we continue our fellowship time. It's one of my favorite parts of every morning. Let's go ahead and work our way back to our seats. Let me pray and we'll continue our time in worship this morning. Father, good morning, Lord. It is a privilege once again here in this place to come before you, to come sing your praises, to connect with one another. And Father, as we gather this morning, we truly want to tell you how much we adore you. And we thank you, Lord, for who you are. And Lord, that the church would not even exist if it weren't for the name and the action, the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross and his resurrection. So, Father, thank you for making the church happen through your faithful promise of Jesus. And Lord, thank you that you've called us to be a part of your church. Father, Lord, as we gather this morning, there are many that are on our hearts, Lord. Hear our prayers as we think and we pray and we lift up our brothers and our sisters, Lord, that are hurting in various ways. Father, we think this morning, we continue to pray for Tom Clevenger as he continues to battle with cancer. We pray for healing, Lord, complete and entire healing. We pray for guidance with the doctors and nurses in his life that they, as they continue to minister the treatment for him. Lord, we lift up Kim Boughton this morning as over this last week or so, he's been struggling with blood clots. And Father, Lord, what a reminder for all of us, Lord, that boy, this life is short. And so, Lord, this aging thing is not easy. None of us look forward to it, really, other than the reality as we get to be one day with you a little sooner. But, Lord, we lift up Kim this morning. We pray for healing for him. Give him wisdom with the doctors, we pray as well. We pray that you protect his body. Lord, he has done so much in your kingdom. The work of his hands and his heart, Lord, has been evidenced in and through his life and his wife Terry's life and their kids' lives. We thank you for them. They're faithful members here, Lord. And so, Lord, we ask for complete and entire healing. For we believe there is so much more you have yet for them to do. Father, we pray for Jordan Voss this morning. We're not sure what's going on with his leg also, Lord, but we pray for him as he goes to see the doctor as well. Lord, you know the many other names that are on our hearts, and Lord, we pray that you'd hear and answer our prayers according to your will. Father, we thank you that we can just quiet our hearts for a moment this morning in a very busy life, a busy world we live in, and we can reach out to you. So Lord, as we do that, Lord, and as we continue our time of worship, as we sing your praises, Lord, we pray that you'd bring glory to yourself. Reveal to us this morning another piece of who you are and the grace of the good news that you have given us through the name of Jesus. Father, we pray these things in the powerful name of Jesus, and all God's people said, amen. Let's stand and continue our time of worship this morning.
I love our church family. As I look up, I see our sound guy holding a baby. Good job, Jordan.
Thank you.
close, close to your side. So heaven is real and death is a lie. I want to hear voices of angels above singing as one, hallelujah. Holy, holy, God Almighty, the great I am, who is worthy, none beside thee. God Almighty, the great I am. I wanna be near, near to your heart, loving the world and hating the dark. I wanna see dry bones living again, singing as one, hallelujah. Before you, the demons run and flee. At the mention of your name, King of Majesty, there is no power in hell or any who can stand before the power and the presence of the great I am. The great I am. The great I am. Shake before you, the demons run and flee. At the mention of your name, King of Majesty, there is no power in hell or any who can stand before the power and the presence of the great I am. Great I am. Great I am.
I was buried beneath my shame. I met you.
You called my name, and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness, into your glorious day. You called my name, and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
Now your mercy has saved my soul. Now your freedom is all I know.
The old made new, Jesus, when I met you. You called my name, and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness, into your glorious day. You called my name, and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
I needed rescue, my sin was heavy. When chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven.
When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open. When you call my name, I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness, into your glorious day. You call my name, and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
How we doing out there? Today we're reading out of Titus, chapter 1, verse 1 through 16. Paul, a servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, for the sake of the faith of God's elect and their knowledge of the truth, which accords with godliness, in hope of eternal life with God, who never lies, promised before the ages began, and at the proper time manifested in his word, through the preaching with which I have been entrusted by the command of God our Savior, to Titus, my true child in a common faith. Grace and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Savior. This is why I left you in Crete, so that you might put what remained into order, and appoint elders in every town as I directed you. If anyone is above reproach, the husband of one wife, and his children are believers, and not open to the change to the charge of debauchery or insubordination. For an overseer, as God's steward, must be above reproach. He must not be arrogant or quick-tempered, or a drunkard, or violent, or greedy but hospitable, a lover of God, self-controlled, upright, holy, and disciplined. He must hold firm to the trustworthy word as taught, so that he may be able to give instruction in sound doctrine and also to rebuke those who contradict it. For there are many who are insubordinate, empty talkers, and deceivers, especially those of the circumcision party. They must be silenced, since they are upsetting whole families by teaching the shameful gain what they ought not to teach. One of the Cretans, a prophet of their own, said, "Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, lazy gluttons. This testimony is true. Therefore, rebuke them sharply, that they may be sound in the faith, not devoting themselves to Jewish myths and the commands of people who turn away from the truth. To the pure, all things are pure, but to the defiled and unbelieving, nothing is pure. But both their minds and their consciences are defiled. They profess to know God, but they deny him by their works. They are detestable, disobedient, unfit for any good work." This is the word of God.
All right, Root students, we have a brand new game that I'm going to teach you today. I'm going to teach you all the rules and everything. It's called Balloon Pop.
I don't like that. Right.
So I'm going to give a balloon.
What's with the title?
It's super creative, I know.
Yeah, not really.
Piece of string, a balloon.
What are you supposed to do with this?
Now what you're going to do, go ahead and blow up your balloon. And I want you to blow up your balloon about the size of a volleyball, not any bigger or smaller. And then you're going to tie the string to the end of the balloon. And then you're going to tie the string to your ankle. And then the purpose of the game is when I say go, you're going to try to pop each other's balloons, and the last person standing with their balloon wins. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Hold on. Wait a sec. What are you doing?
Winning?
No. You have to blow it up big enough that someone could actually pop your balloon, okay? The instructions said about as big as a volleyball. So everybody blow your balloons up about as big as a volleyball. See theirs?
Yes,
perfect.
Ryan.
Okay. All right, once we get this situated, so you want to tie it around your ankle. No, wait, what are you doing?
You never said we could tie it around my knee, so I did.
Okay.
That's true.
Yeah, okay. So I didn't say you couldn't tie it around your knee, but I did say specifically tie it around your ankle. You guys, you can't add and take away from what I've told you to do, okay? Otherwise, the game just doesn't work. So tie it around your ankles. Your balloon looks good. Do you need help with your balloon, or are you good?
I got it.
You got it? Okay. All right, now. Once you get that situated, I'm going to count to three. I'll say one, two, three, and I'll say go. And when I say go, do you guys understand what you're going to do?
I'm going
to
win.
Race to the other end.
Wait, what did you say?
Race to the other end.
No, okay. You're going to try to pop balloons, okay?
Oh.
And you don't want your balloon to get popped. Does that make sense?
I'm going to try to win.
Yeah, that sounds like a three-legged race without my balloon.
Okay, are you guys ready?
Yeah, I was confused.
Yeah.
You guys are helping my prayer life.
You're welcome. Okay.
On the count of three, are you guys ready?
Oh yeah.
Yep.
Okay. Y'all are going down.
Two, three,
no,
go!
No!
Frick.
I win! Come on!
What?
Cheater!
What? Oh, okay, what were you doing?
I was laying on your balloon.
No one could pop it then.
And what do you mean you win?
Well, you said if somebody else popped my balloon, I'm out, right?
Yeah.
Well, I popped my own balloon, so now I can't get out.
Okay, that's brilliant.
Oh my gosh, I wish I could have thought of that.
Okay. You guys, listen to me for just a second, okay? Mm-hmm. Okay, the rules are simple. I explained them to you clearly. The problem is you're adding to and you're taking away from the rules to make it fit yourself. And it just doesn't work that way. You're not even participating in the game. You're just doing your own thing. So we're going to try this one more time. I want you to listen really carefully to the instructions and follow them as they were intended, okay?
Mm-hmm.
No more and no less.
All All right, so if I can have the ushers hand out our balloons for everybody this... No. That'd be kind of slightly entertaining. I'm not sure if Ryan typecasted who was in that skit or not. A little bit, okay. You know, say that again, Anna.
It's kind of obvious.
Oh, I'm not touching that with a big blue balloon. All right, turn in your Bibles this morning, you guys. We're going to try and stay on the line. We're going to, that skit was great because it really demonstrated how we want to push the rules. We want to go above the rules, or we want to, you know, go around the rules somehow, above, below, whatever. But it's difficult for us to be on the line oftentimes. Well, this morning we're going to try to, we want to be faithful not only this morning, but each morning, to be on the line of Scripture. And we're going to talk about that in a moment as we enter into this beginning of our series in the book of Titus. Before we do that, or as we do that, friends, you know, thousands and thousands of years ago, truth ruled over this world. Do you know it? Thousands of years ago, truth ruled over this world. At that time, it was paradise. At that time, man walked with God. All man knew what was good, what was upright, and what was holy. They walked with God. They talked with God. They lived out the very spoken words of God, the guide that God gave them by His Word, the Word that created all things. He spoke and it created all things. There wasn't a single bit of falsehood or sin in the world in the beginning. There was no falsehood to be seen or heard of. And there was no sorrow in the beginning. And there was nothing that would be called lies or falsehoods. But then there's this one day we're probably all familiar with it. We've probably grown up, many of us grown up in Sunday school, hearing about it and hearing about it in church, that there was this one day after creation. There's this day that came, and the father of lies came, and he entered into the garden as a serpent. And he uttered lies in the garden as the very first time. And he spoke to the woman, and she believed the lies, and she partook of the fruit. And she handed the fruit to her husband, as Scripture says, who was with her. And from that day, all the way to this day, June the 9th, 2019, Satan's lies hold this world, and he continues to maintain his portion of power over the world. Satan continues to encourage his lies and to promote his propaganda throughout the world. We can see his lies, can't we? We see his lies throughout the secular world. We can even see that his lies have actually gotten into the fabric of the church. So no matter if we're in the world or in the church, we are bombarded at some levels with lies every day. Falsehood is everywhere. It's entertained by the wealthiest and the poor. It's entertained by every tongue and every tribe, every race, every society on the globe. In fact, if you study church history, what we would find is that every generation of church history from the time, shortly after the time that Jesus ascended, there have been lies that have infiltrated into the church. There have been teachers of falsehoods. Every single generation since Jesus ascended. Now, what an uplifting, right? Right? We'll get to the uplifting part in a moment about God's grace. But I want us to understand where the sin and falsehood first came from and how it has infiltrated the world and it has worked its way into the church. I've enjoyed from time to time reading sermons from different pastors of yesteryear, different theologians. One of them I have enjoyed reading is Charles Spurgeon. He was a pastor in the 1800s. Let me read an excerpt. He actually was teaching on Titus chapter 1, and I remember what I read. I went back and I found it, and I want to share this with you this morning. Here's what Charles Spurgeon said in the mid-1800s. He said, "There are those wearing the vestments of God's priests who do not hesitate to profess what they do not believe. It's nothing less than detestable hypocrisy and robbery. And what shall I say of men of all creeds, all subscribing to the same articles and catechism, when all the world knows they cannot all honestly believe the same thing, and yet differ as much from one another as light is from the darkness? What shall I say? But that shame covers my face, that there should be so many ministers of God who are untrue to their convictions and continue to do and say what they feel to be unscriptural. Brethren, he continues, brethren, talking to the church, we have everywhere to battle with falsehood. And if we are to bless this world, we must confront falsehood with a sturdy face and a zealous spirit. Catch this. God's purpose is to drive the lie out of this world, and let this be our purpose as a church and my purpose as a minister of the gospel. Why don't we just pray and go home, right? That's the heart of what we're going to see here as we enter into the book of Titus. We're going to see what went on in Titus's day, what Paul is talking to young Titus. You could call him Pastor Titus, his own apprentice, and he's saying, look, we have to fight the falsehoods. We have to fight the lies that have entered. They had infiltrated the church, the early church, and that's what Paul is telling young Titus. He's saying, Titus, I've left you in the Isle of Crete. Crete is, if you're familiar, it's by Greece. It's an island. It's about 135 miles long. It's 7 to 35 miles wide, and it's kind of treacherous to travel across. So what we have, what we understand as we walk into the text here, is that Paul has left Titus to this island and saying, Titus, be a faithful elder, overseer, pastor, town to town. And let me tell you, Titus, here's what you're going to come up against. There are falsehoods that are being taught in each of these, maybe not 100% of these little gathering church gatherings across the island, but certainly, obviously, we'll see in the text that it was pretty prevalent. So there's falsehood that Titus had to address, and he would have to take it with great courage. And he had to instruct the church, certainly, what they ought to do when someone is raising something above the Word of God and expecting more than the gospel of Jesus Christ. What was Titus to do when he came into those church gatherings? How was he going to handle it? We're going to see that this morning. First, let me pray. Father, Lord, I pray as we gather in this place this morning, Lord, Lord, I pray that the words that are heard this morning are not mine, Lord, but that they are yours. Lord, we come together this morning not to hear a man speak. We come, Lord, to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ and the instruction that we get from it, that we might grow in your likeness, that we might become more and more faithful to your spoken word. And recognize, Lord, as we open up this book, open up this letter, that, Lord, there will be difficulties in your church. There always has been. And, Lord, until the time that you call us all to be with you, Lord, there will be. So, Lord, in the meantime, Lord, help us to understand this text as we are to understand it here in 2019, that we might be faithful to it and to live it out for your glory. So, Father, I pray, Lord, you would simply speak. And we'd hear your voice, your word, your living, breathing word to instruct us today. I pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. Titus chapter 1, starting with verse 1. Paul, a servant of God, an apostle of Jesus Christ, for the sake of the faith of God's elect, and their knowledge of the truth, which accords with godliness in hope of eternal life, which God, who never lies, promised before the ages began, at the proper time manifested in his word through the preaching with which I have been entrusted by the command of God, our Savior. To Titus, my true child in a common faith, grace and peace from God, the Father, and Christ Jesus, our Savior. I know many of our men's groups this week were focusing in actually on this text, to unpack this text rightly, to learn how to expose the scriptures for themselves together. It's what we were doing over the summer on our men's Trek 11. And so each one of you would have broken the text. I've heard some great comments from many of the men's group. And so one of the jobs is to take and see the author's understanding of the text, his thought process. And so here's the first break in the text this morning. And some of the challenge to the men was to actually reword those first four verses into something simple that we could understand. What was Paul's point to the original author through the cross to us today? And I would say this. Here's what Paul is making clear in the first four verses. That God's grace received by faith is expressed through the faithful proclamation of God's word. It's here that we see, actually, when we open Titus's the letter to Titus, it's actually one of the longest introductions the Apostle Paul has out of all the letters that he writes. And what he does here in these first couple of verses, notice what he does as we expose this text. He takes himself, he takes his own life, and he takes his calling as proof to Titus and ultimately to us today of what is most important. Notice what he says in these first two verses. He says, his life was given for the sake of the elect, those who God was calling to his own, those who would come to salvation. Paul is recognizing and telling Titus that is why what his life had been given to is for the sake of the elect, to evangelize through the faithful proclamation of the word. And number two, Paul says, he says, it is for their knowledge of the truth. And then we see in verse 3, Paul says, Paul knew that his life calling was given by the command of Jesus Christ, his Savior, and what he was to do was to preach the word, have a faithful evangelizing, using the faithful proclamation of the word of God. He was to take the truth of God and make it known to all people. Now, you might be asking this morning, where does truth come from? Look at verse 3 with me. Paul says, here's what truth is. It's manifested in his word. Manifested in the word of God through the faithful preaching of it. Now, here at Timberline, this is what we call expository preaching. You've probably heard that term many times if you've been with us for any period of time. I've been reading through Jared Wilson's book called The Pastor's Justification, and he gives a pretty good definition of what expository preaching actually is. Here's what he says. What expository preaching aims to do is to explicate what the text means, expound on how it applies to the lives of the hearers, and explains its connection to the gospel story line of the Bible. And then Jared Wilson continues about a paragraph later. He says, it's because the gospel is a God-authored story, we come proclaiming his wisdom revealed in Christ, not our wisdom as preachers. We come proclaiming the gospel story that God authored through human authors. We come proclaiming. That's what faithful preaching, that was what the word of God was intended to do, was to be taught properly, to be exposed verse by verse by verse, passage by passage, so that we can understand the fullness of the gospel storyline, that no matter if you're in the Old Testament or you're in the New Testament, the Old Testament points to the coming fulfillment of Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior. The New Testament affirms Jesus Christ, the finished work on the cross, our Lord and Savior. And so our goal, every faithful preacher's goal when it comes to teaching in an expository way, is to stay what we call on the line of Scripture. Or as we saw in the skit this morning, I really appreciate it, Ryan was having a challenge because he's saying, here's the guide, here's the rules of engagement. Don't go above them, don't go below them, stick to the rules that are put into place. But have you noticed? We all have the tendency to want to add more or to take away some. It's a natural tendency. It's that sin nature in us that the enemy wants us to live above the Word of God or below the Word of God. Let me demonstrate that this morning for you. Look at this cool new technology. Well, we'll see how it works. Let's say it before it's cool, right? All right, let's see how this works. Here's what I'm talking about. It really makes my ugly squares look a whole lot nicer, doesn't it? Isn't that good, right? Oh, it bores you. I thought it was really cool. Okay, here's the line of Scripture. You ready? Let's see if I can get this right. Oh, hey, that's kind of cool. Did that come up in green on there too? Yeah. Here's the line of Scripture. It's the Bible. Or what we try to do as faithful expositors of the Word, we try to walk the line. Or Johnny Cash would be pretty proud, right? Walk the line. Walk the line of the Word of God. But here's oftentimes what can happen. There are those. Oh, hey, let's see if that goes like that. There are those. Who want to go above the line. And then, in the same way, there are those who want to walk below the line. See, what we are called to do as Christ followers is to learn walk on that line. Not to go above it, not to add anything to it, and not to fall below it, and not hold up to what the Word of God proclaims for our lives, our instruction book, if you will. Legalism is this. It's taking that the gospel isn't good enough, that the Word of God isn't complete, so therefore we're going to add things to it. Liberalism says, oh, I don't really like this portion of Scripture. I want to take my knife out and cut out that verse, or I want to cut out that passage, or I want to just take my scissors and I just want to cut that whole book out of the Bible. That's living in a liberalistic mindset. And it should not be that way. Jared Wilson says in his book, he says, the Bible is the only infallible authority over our lives. It is malpractice to treat it as a supporting document for our own good ideas. When we come to the biblical text, when we come to the walking the line right there in the middle, when we come to the biblical text, it is meant to shape us. We are not to shape it. We are the ones to be malleable, not the Bible. The Bible's words are to be the authoritative power in our lives. So what was this message, this Bible message, this line that Paul was calling Titus to make very clear for the churches across Crete? He says for us, let's see if I can shut that off. There we go. He says for us in verses 1 to 4, take a look. He repeats some very key words that we need to understand. In verses 1 and 4, he says these words, there's faith, there's grace, and there is peace. We call it the gospel of Jesus Christ that comes by God's grace that brings peace to its hearers when it's received by faith. Paul wrote also over in the book of Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, he says, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith. It is not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that none of us can boast. If you're familiar with the book of Ephesians, both in Ephesians and here in the book of Titus, verse 2, we see that God promised before the time ever began, before the ages ever began, that he had an answer for the falsehoods, for the sin of the world. And that answer is the saving work of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ came, my friends. He came as a sinless man, fully God, fully man. He came to earth. He gave his life. His death was placed on the cross. His blood was poured out on the cross for the redemption of sins. And his resurrection provides for us by our confession of sin and our belief by faith in him that his work is finished. And what Paul says is because of his grace, because of that beautiful grace message, and because of our faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ, he says in verse 2, this is the hope of eternal life for all who believe by faith. Friends, this is the gospel that Paul proclaims and proclaimed and proclaims in each one of his letters. This is also the gospel that we see Titus had taken to in verse 4 when it says, to Titus, my true child, in a common faith. This is the same gospel that Titus took for himself and believed by faith. This is the same gospel that we proclaim day in and day out here at Timberline. And as Charles Spurgeon once said, he goes, it is the whole business of the whole church to preach the whole gospel to the whole world. So if you know this gospel, this beautiful gospel of grace, it's not just for the preachers to preach this gospel of grace. It's for all of us to receive it and to share this grace message with the world. The question for each of us this morning is, do you know this beautiful gospel of grace? Do you know it by faith? Do you have the hope of eternal life that Paul had, that Titus has, or had. Verse 5. This is why I left you in Crete, Paul says, so that you might put what remained into order and appoint elders in every town as I directed you. If anyone is above reproach, the husband of one wife, his children are believers and not open to the charge of debauchery or insubordination. For an overseer as God's steward must be above reproach. He must not be arrogant or quick-tempered or a drunkard or violent or greedy for gain, but hospitable, a lover of good, self-controlled, upright, holy, and disciplined. He must hold firm to the trustworthy word as taught so that he may be able to give instruction in sound doctrine and also to rebuke those who contradict it. I love how Paul very clearly puts the qualifications and instructions for appointing elders for Titus, that they might hold firm to the word of God and the sound doctrine within the word. There's a number of times Paul, throughout his letters, talks again and again about his concern for appointing godly, Christ-centered, qualified elder, overseer, pastors in his churches. It was obviously clear he wanted to make sure that that's what Titus's first focus would be, is to raise up qualified elder, pastor, overseers. He says in verse 5, he says, there's things that were remained that need to be put into order. What we can understand there is that obviously Paul, when he was once there, had begun the process of raising up godly leaders, but for whatever reason needed to continue on his missionary journey. And so what he was saying to Titus is, continue the work that I had begun. Raise up, equip and train, disciple these the up-and-coming elders that could go and lead with great courage, men of great character. And what we're going to see here in just a few moments when we get to verse 10 is that in the time of Paul's absence to the time of Titus's coming, that what we might call as wolves have entered into the church. False teachers had entered into the church. And we're going to talk about that and what Paul tells Titus he needs to do in order to correct the falsehoods that had made its way into the church. Now, just for fun this morning, look at the person to your right. Just take a second. Look at the person to your right. Okay, now turn and look at the person to your left. Okay, now look back up here, if you want. Here's a disclaimer. You ready? The qualifications of an elder that we see not only in Titus 1, but also in 1 Timothy chapter 3 are often taken very legalistically in the church. It has happened for generation after generation in the church. And the reason I had you look right and look left is simply this. You ready? There is only, from my calculation, and now math is not my strongest suit, But by my calculation, there is actually only one person that has actually qualified fully and perfectly to the qualifications that Paul puts in verses 6 through 9 of qualified elder, pastor, overseers. Do you get me? So when you look at your brother and your sister to your right and to your left, what I want you to understand is there is nobody perfect except for Jesus. He's the only one that is truly qualified. He's the only one that's perfect according to all those verses. So let's look at how we are actually then, therefore, to raise up elders that are qualified because we are fallible. Look at verse 6 and 7 with me for a moment. There's a phrase that Paul repeats twice, back to back, in verse 6 and 7. We should pay special notice when Paul repeats himself like that. These are the words, above reproach. Above reproach. He says it both of those times. And here's what he is saying. In verse 6, he says that a qualified elder, a qualified overseer, pastor in the church, must be above reproach in his relationships. First and foremost, with his wife, and secondly, with their children. And then secondly, a pastor, overseer, elder, is to be above reproach in the very character, their godly character of their lives. Let's unpack this just for a moment this morning. Let's start with verse 6, looking at the one what it says, the husband of one wife. Of probably all of these characteristics, I think this is the one that I have heard most legalistically approached over the generations of the church. First of all, let me tell you what it's not saying. Here's what I believe Paul is not saying. He's not saying that an elder, overseer, pastor must be married. I've known very good pastors that have been overlooked for a pastorate because they actually weren't married yet. They were being selective and they hadn't found God's given spouse for them yet, and a church would not put them into place because they were not married. That's a bit of a legalistic approach, my friends. That is above the line of Scripture in its teaching. Here's how we know that that's not what Paul meant. You ready? Paul, Titus, and actually Jesus would have not been qualified to be an elder in the church if that's what Paul meant, that they had to be married. Okay, so let's move on. Here's the second thing it's not saying, that if a man loses his wife for some sort of maybe an early death, a car accident or whatever the case, I've known pastors that have actually been removed from the pulpit because their spouse had died an early death, an unknown death. I mean, been removed because he was not any longer a husband of one wife. That again is above the line teaching. Let's move on. Third, this is not what Paul is saying. And here it is, that a man who was once biblically divorced, either as a believer or a non-believer, cannot be an elder, overseer, pastor. If that were the case, again, it would immediately have disqualified, and if you're ready for this, I believe, you're welcome to disagree with me on this, but I believe it would have disqualified the Apostle Paul. Now, here's why I stand on that. First and foremost, a number of scholars believe that Paul was married at one time in his life. Why do we say that? Because it would have been, when Paul, before Jesus, before he came to faith, he was a high-ranking Pharisaical official. And it was historical, it was normal, it would be so radically unusual for some high-ranking Pharisee to not already be married. It would have been an anomaly, basically. And so what we can understand from the Scripture is certainly silent, but something happened somewhere between his Pharisaical days and 1 Corinthians chapter 7 when he says, I wish you were single like me. So I fall into the camp, you're welcome to not fall into this camp, But here I fall into the camp that there was Paul, once upon a time he had been married, and we do not know what actually happened. When we get to heaven, if we really care, we can ask him. But I'm probably not going to be so worried about it. Anybody going to worry about that? Anyone? Okay, I'm not either. Good. Okay. What Paul is saying, my friends, let's get to the point. What he is saying is literally what the Greek says, is that he's a faithful one-woman man. He is faithful to the one woman that he is married to. Now, friends, let me be really, really clear. I know a number of men who have been married maybe 20, 30, longer years, who are actually, they're married. They've never been divorced. but they are actually not a one-woman man. That man would not be qualified to be an elder in God's church. They might have a secret addiction going on. They might have somebody on the side. Whatever the case may be, they are not what Paul is talking about. He's saying a man who's qualified to be an elder, overseer, pastor is one who is faithful to that woman that he is married to. Now, secondly, Paul goes on and he says they need to be above reproach with their relationship with their children. The word in the Greek here is technon. It generally relates to the children in the home that are under the parents' authority. Kent Hughes in his commentary says this: we should not hold pastors or leaders accountable for the actions of independent adult children as we do for the children while they're under the care and authority of their parents or supervision of their parents. The word Paul is using here is a plural word. He uses it for children. He doesn't say a child's faith. He says their children. So what we should look at is actually the beliefs and the actions of the children as a whole. They will be a representation of the character of the family setting. We don't take just one experience of a poor choice by a child and say, see, they're not in faith, so therefore that pastor's not qualified. In rightly understood, let's look at the heart of the family and recognize their belief and their actions. In fact, the word believers in verse 6 is from the word pistos, and it's probably translated better the word faithful. Instead of believers, it would be faithful. So, in other words, are the beliefs and actions of the family in their beliefs and conduct made over time in alignment with the gospel? What Paul is not concerned about is each individual child's faith testimony, although he would be, but it's really he's talking about the heart and character above reproach of the family as a whole. Then Paul goes on in verses 7 and 8, and he talks, he gives 5 negative attributes and 6 positive attributes of a qualified elder. He says that a qualified elder ought not be arrogant, which is literally self-pleasing. They're not to be quick-tempered or drunkard, which means given too much wine. They are certainly able to partake unless they have a problem with that, then they would be a drunkard. They should not be a drunkard. They should not be violent, one who strikes out. They should not be greedy for financial gain. But what they should be is hospitable. They should be open to the friendship with strangers. They ought to love what is good. They ought to be self-controlled, which is, means that they are not impulsive and damaging to the behaviors with their behavior to others. They are to be upright, first before God and then to others. They ought to be holy, which means they are a committed person to godly living. And lastly, he says, they ought to be disciplined. It kind of gives that imagery of an athlete who trains faithfully to become a disciplined man of the word, a man who grows in his godly character day by day. And I think the reason that Paul gives all of these attributes and all of these qualifications and instruction is simply this. We see it in verse 9 this morning. Here's why. He needs to know the Word of God. He needs to be living out the Word of God. He needs to be growing in the Word of God for 3 reasons. Number one, if he's to be an elder, he needs to be able to hold firm to the trustworthy to the trustworthy Word. Number two, he needs to be able to give faithful, sound doctrine as instruction for those that tarry. And number 3, that elder, overseer, pastor needs to be able to rebuke those that contradict the word by using the word of God to bring them to truth. And then lastly, this morning, we come to verses 10 through 16. And it's what we see here is we see false teachers are to be rebuked so that they may become sound in good works and in their faith. Notice what Paul is actually saying to Titus. He's saying with these false teachers, what you ought to do is take the word of God and instruct them with the word of God. Teach them the word of God and ultimately pray that God would break through in their lives, that they could actually understand this gospel of grace that we are called to by faith. So Paul says, here, Titus, here's how you're going to know who are false teachers as you come from town to town. He gives 5 markers of a false teacher. Number 1, we see in verse 10, it says that they are insubordinate to sound doctrine. Number two, that they are empty talkers. Their words, their doctrine is empty. Number three, that they are deceitful. Paul even uses a reference from the Isle of Crete. He says in verse 12, one of the Cretans, a prophet of their own, said that Cretans are always liars and evil beasts and lazy gluttons. Basically, he's saying they are deceitful. And number four, he says that they are shameful. They teach what is shameful, probably for shameful financial gain. Now, Paul tells us who these people are. He says in verse 10, he says, these people are of the circumcision party. Now, if we had time this morning, we could go back to Acts chapter 10. We could go over to Galatians chapter 2, and we could learn more about who these people of the circumcision party actually are, what they were actually doing. We don't have time for all of that this morning, but basically, what we could say is this. They were former Jews who joined the church with a gospel plus type of mindset. In other words, they took the Bible, the line of scripture that God calls us to live on, and they were legalistically adding to the grace gospel. It would have sounded something like this. Yeah, you're saved by the work of Jesus Christ on the cross, plus you need to know these certain things, or you need to focus on a certain diet, or you need to fast every so often, or you need to say a certain thing, or you have to have a certain practice, or you have to act in a certain way in order to please and be approved by God. What we see in Acts chapter 10 and Galatians 2 is those were all man-made. Those were all man-made things that were placed on top of the line of Scripture. They were not commanded by God. They were not instructed by God. Friends, let me be very clear. At the very core, here's what the line of Scripture says. Here's what the gospel says. You ready? It's worth writing down. It's three simple words. It is finished. The work of Jesus Christ was finished on the cross for our redemption. Amen? Here's how you know when you come across some legalistic teaching. You ready? It sounds like this. You aren't finished. You aren't finished. My friends, what we want to proclaim to you this morning and every morning, every day, is this. It is finished. Finished. That is the gospel. And you can take it to the bank. A gospel mindset, unfortunately, it still finds its way into the church today. It's when people fall to the lies of Satan that the finished work of Jesus Christ isn't enough. But what Paul says very clearly to Titus in verse 11, he tells them what to do with those who add to the gospel. Or if I could tell us today what we should do when we find somebody who says the finished work of Jesus is not enough and they add to it or they expect you to live a certain way, or if they come shy of it and they're living in a liberal mindset, here's what Paul says we ought to do in verse 11. He says they must be silenced. Because what they were doing was upsetting family after family after family. And Paul says in verse 13, rebuke them sharply by using sound doctrine with the hope that they may possibly become sound in the faith. And then we come to the fifth and final marker of a false teacher here in chapter 1. We see it in verse 16 where Paul says, it says, they profess to know God, but they deny him by their works. They're detestable, disobedient, and unfit for any good work. James chapter 2, 17 says, so also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. As Christ followers, our faith and our works are inseparable. And so what we can do is we can tell by a false teacher that they may say, profess they know God, but when you look at the fruit of their lives, there is none. It's empty. I believe that since shortly after Jesus' ascension, part of Satan's plan has been to infiltrate the church with falsehood, with lies. I think that's been part of his plan ever since. And I would propose to you that even every good, faithful, Christ-centered gathering has those that try to infiltrate the church that are what Paul calls wolves in other passages of Scripture. It's been part of Satan's plan. And you're gonna see them come in and through here. Trust me. We've had them before. We will probably have them again, unless Jesus calls us to be with him, which can't be any too soon. We're going to know them because they're false teachers. They profess to know God, but at the very core, they're either legalists or they're liberalists, living above the line or below the line. And our responsibility as a church and our responsibility as elders is going to be where we call out those who teach above or below the line teaching. And what we do is we use the gospel, the grace gospel of Jesus Christ, to call them out and to invite them either up to the line of Scripture or down to the line of Scripture. So what do we do with this text this morning? I believe there's three different groups that are gathered in our setting this morning. Number one, there are those who are unbelievers. You came in here this morning, maybe you're pursuing, you're wondering, is this gospel? Maybe you're saying, I don't know how I got here, but I'm here. And I, for the first time in my life, I heard something about God is gracious if I would just put my faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ. And let me be clear, if that describes you this morning, there is not a single sin that you could have done in your life that Jesus didn't take on the cross and bear on your behalf. And he is filled with grace. If you will just confess your sin and invite Jesus Christ to be the Lord and Savior of your life. Notice I didn't say invite him into your heart. Because my friends, he doesn't just want your heart. He wants all of you. 110% of you he wants. And he will use you for his glory. And he will come in to your life. And he, by his grace and your faith in him, he will give what Paul said back in verse 4. He said, he will give you peace. Peace that you have never experienced before in your life. And so this morning, in a moment or two, we're going to just have a time of quiet reflection right where we're seated. And if that describes you this morning, I just invite you, sit right where you're at and have a conversation with God and invite him to be the Lord and Savior. Invite Jesus to be the Lord and Savior of your life. And then before you go, tell somebody that you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. The next group that's here this morning is to the church. I've got three quick points for you this morning. Number one, the character qualifications that we see in verses 6-8 this morning are not just character qualifications for elders and pastors. They are actually character qualifications or qualities of every Christ follower. All of us are called to live above reproach if we're married in our marriages, if we have children with our families. No matter where we are to live above reproach. And we are not to be arrogant or quick-tempered or drunkards or violent or greedy, but instead, what ought to characterize us is our hospitality and our lovers of being good, of what is good and self-controlled and upright and holy lives and disciplined lives in the name of Jesus. This morning, as you hear those character qualities, maybe one or two or many of them jump out at you, and you go, man, I really need help with those. This morning, in our quiet time of reflection, I just invite you quietly go to the Lord and confess that which you have been struggling with and invite him to help you correct what is not good in your life that he wants you to change. And he is there to live in you and help you. Number two, very clearly, hold firm to the faithful teaching as it's exposed. My friends, no matter who is teaching, if you see it on TV or radio or here, here's what you want to do. Don't take the preacher's word for it. Take the word of God's word for it every time. Become a student of the word and learn to take the word as it's exposed and apply it to your lives. Number three, church, resist the temptation to live above the line or below the line. Maybe today you've recognized something that you've been doing. You've been adding to the finished work of Christ. You've been living above the line, or you haven't been living up to the line. I invite you to confess that to the Lord this morning as well. And then lastly today, I want to talk to the elders, the overseers, and the pastors here that are gathered. I want to give you guys two charges this morning. Number one, be guardians of the gate to eldership by not letting false teachers rise up and become leaders. It's part of the job of elder overseers is to help guard the gate. And again, we can tell it because people will profess to know the Lord, but by their lives, they are empty. And they would teach a above the line or below the line teaching. And then lastly, elders, pastors, hold firm to the word of God. Give instruction using the word of God and rebuke those who contradict the word of God. Let us pray. Father, Lord, as we come now just to close this morning, Lord, we have a minute or two, Lord, that we're just going to take, and Lord, we want to listen to your spirit, what you're teaching us this morning. Lord, maybe there's something here today that you have convicted each and every one of us in. Lord, I pray that we don't try to just pull ourselves up by our bootstraps and fix it. Lord, that by your spirit, you would help us, Lord, to grow more into your likeness today and every day therefore, forward from here. So Lord, in the quietness in this next moment, I pray, Lord, you would speak to our hearts and you would hear and answer our prayers according to your will. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to let the music play quietly, and then Ryan will come up for a benediction in about a minute or so. Let's go before the Lord this morning and reflect on the message.
In the book of Acts, in chapter 17, Paul and Silas went and preached at a place called Berea. Maybe some of you guys have heard the word, be a Berean. And the reason that we say that is because the people who heard Paul and Silas preach there received the word with all readiness of mind. And it says that they searched the scriptures daily, whether those things were so, and many of them came to believe. And that's exactly what Gary's talking about, and the importance of holding the line is if we don't hold the line, if we go above or below, we put ourselves in slavery. We become slaves if we add to the scriptures, if we add to the word of God, we become slaves to religious legalism. And any of us who have spent a season of our lives in a legalistic mindset, it's not a fun place to be, is it? And it's a hard place to be because it affects the way we view God, and it's a very harsh view a lot of times. Or if we go below the line, like Gary was saying, we become liberal hedonists that just kind of do what we want, and we have no basis for holiness in our lives. And like Gary was talking about with discipline in our lives, that we are called to holiness, that Christ died for you so that you would be crucified with him and given a new life. New creation, new mind, new heart, soft, malleable, teachable by the word of God. So let's be Bereans together. Let's receive the word with readiness of mind. Search the scriptures daily to see if these things are so, and let's believe. Amen? Why don't you guys stand, and I'll give the benediction from 1 Timothy chapter 1. It says this, "But I received mercy for this reason, that in me, as the foremost, Jesus Christ might display his perfect patience as an example to those who were to believe in him for eternal life, to the King of the ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen." We'll see you guys next week. Spend some time connecting. Our kids are still being discipled here for a few more minutes. But spend some time connecting. We'll see you next week.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Chosen me.